this film is not talking about feminism like, you know, how we talk about feminism today. And I don't think male filmmakers can truly be feminists. I think they can be allies more than anything else. But I think what he's really doing, he's looking at the changing power structures of our society. And feminism is just one part of it. This was an impenetrable wall for her. When she was living inside her home, the idea that she could go out and conduct business with strangers, it was a wall that you cannot cross it. So the times are changing, you know, and it is because of the necessity that women are going to step out. You and I can't stop this process. The shot is very, that shot where the light bulb is hanging there. And I think that corresponds to the first image of the film also, which is the tram line. These things happen because of directors and actors' insecurity. Nothing else. When I was making Ishqiya, I showed Vidya a photograph of Madhavendra. Of course, she knew that. It's a woman whose world is really opening up. The Nagar is actually becoming a Mahanagar.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to Filmkopat Video Podcasts. Today on the podcast, we have with us critically acclaimed screenwriter, filmmaker, and producer, Abhishek Chaubey. Abhishek began his career as an associate director and co-writer to Vishal Bhardwaj for his debut, Makri, in the year 2002. He went on to co-write Omkara and Kabine. Abhishek's directorial debut was with the dark comedy Ishqiya, which he followed with a sequel, Der Ishqiya. He made his debut as a producer with Konkana Sen Sharma's A Death in the Goonj in the year 2016. His film Son Chiriya won the Critics Award for Best Film at the 65th Filmfare Awards in 2019. We are also eagerly anticipating his short Hangama Hai Kyun Barpa, based on Satyajit Ray's short story, Barin Bhumi Kir Bairam, which is to release on 25th June as a part of the Ray Anthology. Abhishek sir, thank you so much for joining us for this video podcast.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Sir, tell us about your connection with Ray. How did you get introduced to Ray and his filmmaking, and what was its impact on you?
Well, my growing up years were primarily spent in Bihar what is now Jharkhand. I lived my most important impressionable years, you know, formative years, you could say, in Ranchi. I lived in a colony called Nivaranpur, which was primarily a Bengali colony. I mean, about 75% of the residents were there were Bengali. Of course, Ranchi has a huge influence of the Banga culture, of course. So, I was really growing up on a diet of mainstream Hindi cinema. Living in small town India, that's what you're going to get. You know, it's not that you're getting even Hollywood films, mainstream Hollywood films would not make it to the theaters in Ranchi. And that was the era where you had to, hire a VCR for once a month. And, you know, then you could get to watch the films that were not available. So it was that kind of a time. So there was no question of me watching any Bangla movies or any other kind of films at all. But I do remember very clearly, I don't exactly remember the year this was, but I do remember that Doordarshan was going to show Gopi Gayan Bhagabhai, and there was like a major excitement in the entire colony. You know, everybody was really excited about it, and I joined in the fever. I didn't know what this was about really. And then I spoke to my parents. My parents both are from UP, but they have lived in that part of India since mid 70s. And they could, both my parents can speak Bangla very well. So they had seen the film and they told me, okay, this movie is going to come. You have to sit and watch it. You will really love it. I think that was the only Ray film they had seen also. It's not that they were big cinema streets who have seen all Ray films already. So that was the first time that evening I saw, that's the first film I saw of his. But I mean, I had a great time. I really loved it. I mean, you know, that Bhuter Raja sequel with the lights come on and all that. Of course, I mean, you know, as a child, I really, really enjoyed that film a lot. But that was just an introduction. I did not know. I could not tell Ray from Ritwik Ghatak at that time. No idea. It's only when I went to college in Delhi got interested in the other kind of cinema than one, you know, has access to, the mainstream cinema. That I started watching, you know, his films on, and back then I'm talking about mid-late 90s. Again, it was the VHS era, so we would score VHS and then watch his films. And sometimes Indian Film Festival used to have used to be in Delhi at that time, not in Goa. So they would regularly show Ray films. So I got to watch a few films over there, and you know, the way it happened was that I started when I got introduced to what you could call world cinema or serious cinema. I actually got introduced first to the West, you know, when I started watching it. It was first the French masters or the American masters that you saw, and then you say, hey, I mean, we're not watching this. Luckily, in college also, quite a few of my friends were Bengali, because they are all from Chittaranjan Park area in Delhi. So then I got to watch most of his films over there, you know, and yeah, I mean, it was special. I mean, because you see, the what I keep saying, talking about Ray, I mean, of course, there is no doubt in our minds as we speak that he's the master of film. But there is, apart from, you know, compared to what I feel, say, about a Bergman or a Truffaut, and compared to that, when I speak of Ray, there's also a lot of affection, because he's one of our own. And there's a lot of warmth I feel about him. And that also got to do with who he was. He was a very warm human. His films exuded that personality, that side of his. So that's also what I feel about Ray, very strongly.
So as a part of the Satyajit Ray 100-year centenary celebration, today we will discuss Mohanagar by Ray. Mohanagar is a 1963 Indian Bengali language drama film written and directed by Satyajit Ray, which starred Madhuri Mukherjee in the lead role of Aarti. Based on the short story Avatarinika by Narendranath Mitra, it tells the story of a housewife who disconcerts a traditionalist family by getting a job as a saleswoman. The film, according to veteran film critic Philip French, is one of Ray's greatest films. Satyajit Ray won the Silver Bear for Best Director at the 14th Berlin International Film Festival in 1964 for Mohanagar. It is also Abhishek's favorite films, which we got to know from Smriti from Mami. And it is a pleasure that we are getting to discuss this with him today.
Sir, मुझे मतलब इतनी सारी फिल्में हैं रे साहब की, तो उसमें से आपको महानगर इतनी ज्यादा क्यों पसंद आती? वो क्या एक क्वालिटी है जो आपको उस फिल्म में मतलब स्टैंड आउट लगती है?
जैसे कि लेट मी क्लैरिफाई बिफोर आई बिगिन आंसरिंग दैट क्वेश्चन, तो वही होता है कि रे साहब के साथ ये होता है कि हो सकता है 2022 में मैं कुछ और फिल्म भूल दूं, यू नो, आई शुड नॉट बी
ऑब्वियसली, यस,
बिकॉज़ यू नो इट्स समथिंग लाइक दिस दैट आपने देखी है, उनका काम देखा है, लेकिन महानगर आपने 15 साल से नहीं देखा, एक दिन आपने यू नो मूवी पे आ गए तो देख लिया, देख करके फिर वो फिल्म याद आई, एंड नाउ दैट यू आर मोर मच्योर एंड यू आल्सो बिकम अ फिल्म मेकर, यू हैव डिस्कवर्ड थिंग्स इन इट, यू नो हिथरटू दैट यू वर अनसीन फॉर यू, सो ऑल ऑफ अ सडन यू फॉल इन लव विद दैट फिल्म ऑल ओवर अगेन, एंड आई थिंक दैट्स समथिंग लाइक दैट हैज हैपेंड टू हिम. आई मीन, आई हैव नॉट सीन, फॉर एग्जांपल, आई हैव नॉट सीन Janaranya इन अ लॉन्ग टाइम, सो मे बी इफ आई वॉच इट नाउ मे बी आई विल बी लाइक वाओ. So anyway, so that's what it is. But definitely, even so, Mahanagar is undoubtedly one of his finest films. Also, he made that film at a time, I feel, where I think, you know, he was at the peak of his powers, you know, as an artist. And the reason why I also find that film is very appealing to me is, again, I mean, the one thing that a lot of critics talk about, a lot of film analysts talk about when they talk about Ray is his humanism, you know, and what is that humanism, you know? The issue that Mahanagar is talking about, and there are many, you know, whether he's talking about feminism, whether it's the feminism at its core, or is the power structures at its core, or when is it a critique of patriarchy, or, you know, new capitalism, whatever you might call it, you know, all of that. I mean, everybody has made movies about that. A lot of filmmakers, even Manmohan Desai has made movies about it, you know. However, the sensitivity the affection with which he talks about the characters in this movie, you know. Whether, I mean, in any other movie, the father-in-law or even the husband would be rank villains. Here, you know, you're talking about the husband, you're talking about the father-in-law, you are so sympathetic towards them, you know. They are living in a world that's changing inexorably in front of their eyes, and they just can't deal with it. You know, they're finding it that very hard to deal with it. And you see it, it's almost got a magnifying glass over the camera, you know, where you can see what is going on in their heads. Nobody's so this level of empathy that he has for practically every character. I mean, I think with the exception of the only character who's a bit of a stock character, important character, who's a bit of a stock character, is perhaps her boss, you know, who is just a representative of something. Although he does about his personal side when he talks a little bit about his wife and all of that, but you really don't get into his head so much. But all the other characters, you really, I mean, be it Edith or be it any of those characters, you really understand, empathize with them very, very clearly without any frustration or anger on the filmmaker's part. You know, when filmmakers make movies generally about subjects like this, they have their anger about the system on display, you know, to show how angry they are, you know. And that's none of that. What is there then remains in the film is his understanding of these people, you know. And I think is the power of that film. The quietness with which he says what he has to say, and he says it in no uncertain terms. I think that is the power of that film, and that's why it's so moving.
You know, Abhishek, another, you know, very interesting connection or observation that we had with Mahanagar and your filmmaking is the woman characters. In your films, the woman characters have been remarkable in each of your films. And, you know, there's so many things to like about all of your movies, but they stand out for us. Personally for me, and I think I'm speaking for the others as well. And, Mohanagar is perhaps, you know, Satyajit's most feminist film, a feminist classic in that sense for the context of Indian cinema overall, I would say. What I wanted to know from you is, you know, what do you think about this feminism of Mohanagar, and how difficult do you think is it for a male director, like from your personal experience as well, to get this, you know, female characters of flesh and blood so rightly and maintain all these subtleties and idiosyncrasies at the same point of time?
Yeah. There are two parts to that question. So let's just talk about Mahanagar, the feminism in Mahanagar. There is absolutely no doubt about the fact that the film is about, I mean, when I was watching that film recently, I think the alternate title to the film could be Times They Are Changing, actually. You know, he's trying to show India, Calcutta specifically. I mean, this film is, I think, set in the 50s. It's not set in the 60s. So it's just post-independence India, you know. And one remarkable thing about this film, you know, when it comes to the feminism angle also, is that this film is not talking about feminism like, you know, how we talk about feminism today. And this, when it talks about feminism, when it talks about the woman stepping out of the confines of her home to do her job, she's doing it as an economic necessity. She is not doing kyunki main udna chahti hun, main kuch banna chahti hun, you know, which is how we talk about it today, if you think about it, you know. It's about giving the rights, you know, be giving equal rights. This is not about that. This is not that kind of feminism he's talking about. He's talking about the world is changing, and it is the economic necessity that family has taken this decision. Although three out of the four people are extremely are actually against it. Although the husband, you know, in the beginning, it's almost like fun and games for him. It's nothing. But the moment it becomes a reality, he's distinctly uncomfortable about what's going to happen. Naturally, the father-in-law and the mother-in-law are against it to start with. Even Arati's character, she's not completely sold to the idea, because when she first hears from the husband that some other family, some other friends, their acquaintances, both of them are working, aisa kuch hai, where he says ki both husband and wife are working, she actually frowns because it's an alien idea to her, you know. So this lens at feminism is very different from the way we perceive feminism in the 21st century, you know. And it was born out of an economic necessity. And then we see, as the woman steps out and interacts with the world, he does it in little symbols of lipstick and Edith's character and all of that, you know, so that she starts opening up. She starts getting a sense of power, you know. She also realizes that she's a competent woman. She's a powerful woman in the sense when she first goes to do her job as a sales girl, and I think she rings the bell and runs away from because she doesn't have the confidence to, you know, and she's in this posh neighborhood where the houses are big and it's all neat and clean. But then she goes again and she slowly gains in confidence, and she realizes that, okay, this was an impenetrable wall for her when she was living inside her home. The idea that she could go out and conduct business with strangers, it was a wall that you cannot cross it. And then suddenly it starts seeming easier. And the kind of power she derives when she starts earning money, you know, when she brings gifts for everybody, when she gets her first salary. And you can see the sense of power in her. But at the same time, whenever the husband is uncomfortable, you know, with the lipstick, she throws it. When the husband just says, when the son is not well, he says, ki tu naukri chhod de, so she agrees also. She comes to the boss's room to say, ki main, I'm going to quit, you know. It's just that the husband also has lost his job, so that doesn't happen. So it's a very different way of looking at it. This is not a friend film that's screaming, you know, about it. So it has a very empathetic look at that. This is what is going to happen, you know. Because born out of economic necessity, in order to feed our stomachs, both the husband and the wife will have to step out of their homes to do their job. As it happens, when the wife steps out of her home, she's going to see the world. And you know what what's going to happen? She's going to realize that there's nothing to it. I mean, you know, if he can do it, so can I. That will give her a sense of power. That will give her a agency. That will give her strength, you know. And that's what happens to her. This kind of social change that is going to happen, which is happening in Mahanagar, is going to make us very uncomfortable. So at one level, it is about feminism, but also about a changing world. He's also talking about a changing world. I think what he's really doing, he's looking at the changing power structures of our society. And feminism is just one part of it. It's not, you know, whenever I have also, you know, in my little way, tried to make a movie about, say, for example, in Sojiria has a shade of patriarchy and all of that. You know, when you try to track the script, you realize what you're really talking about is power structure. You know, so power structures are getting demolished, and they're not getting demolished because some leader is, you know, standing at the picket fences and saying, world, please change. It's happening because it happens naturally. The world changes. So we see Madhumi Mukherjee's character getting a sense of power. We see her interacting with another of her kind, but from the other side of the tracks. I mean, you know, the Anglo-Indian woman. And she's modern. And you know, she wears lipstick, which I think is frowned upon a middle-class conservative woman in the 1950s. And she finds this girl very warm, very sweet, very nice. Whatever ideas she must have had as a conservative Bengali upper caste woman about, Anglo-Indians who were looked upon a certain way post-independence, that starts changing. And I think one very, very subtly done, when Aarti's character walks into Edith's home, if you notice, Edith's home is a lot like Aarti's own home. You know, if you see the art direction, it's just like, so there you have it, two women from, you know, completely different milieus, they connect and they find that there is more similarity, you know, between us than differences, like the world has been telling us. So it's a woman whose world is really opening up. The Nagar is actually becoming a Mahanagar because she's seeing it, you know, now from completely a different perspective. And so definitely there are strong tones of feminism, you know, when little things like lipstick and the sunglasses, and then the husband watching the wife meeting a stranger on the street and overhearing that conversation. You know, when the husband character sees the woman, sees his wife with a stranger, the first thing that strikes us as the audience and the husband is like, oh shit, is she having, she's going out and she's meeting strange men, she's having an affair, and she's like got the newspaper ki main sab sununga ki kya ho raha, and the entire conversation is turned on its head because she's actually protecting him over there,
right?
You know, yes. So he feels even more ashamed and runs away from there, you know. So the times are changing, you know, and it is because of the necessity that women are going to step out. You and I can't stop this process. You know, only obscurantists like, you know, and people like that will try and stop this changing, you know, wheel, you know, that's going to happen with our society. And this will happen. This will make us uncomfortable, but we better gear up. We better get ready for it. I mean, that seems to be what he's saying in a certain way. Yeah.
There's also this, you know, breaking of this myth where we say that woman is a woman's biggest enemy in the way she kind of stands for Edith.
Yeah. Yeah, there are a couple of lines. There is one when he says, the big husband also says something like, no, the woman's place is that is
Is
at home. A woman's
at home. He quotes the
idea, which I try not to say it because my Bangla is very bad, but he says something like "Striyer Paush Mas
Bade Sharmonash."
Bade Sharmonash.
So I mean, those lines are there, you know. But I do feel one thing. I mean, it's very simple to look at this film from a feminist lens. From the when I mean feminism, I talk about it politically as a movement. So then it's very easy to look at it primarily from a feminist lens. But I think he's just using the woman character and her world opening up to talk about something even larger than that. I think what he's really talking about a society that's changing, and the change cannot be stopped, and the power structures are getting demolished and new structures are coming up. And, you know, so that's what he's really talking about, I think.
I think, like, because if I remember correctly, in the closing scene, when they're walking into the city, we have these two lampposts which are blinking, kind of suggesting, you know, both have to handshake and then only they can stand.
Yes, yes. And that shot is very, that shot where the light bulb is hanging there. And that I think that corresponds to the first image of the film also, which is the tram line.
Yes.
Spark, you know, you see the spark in that. So I think it's a book ending, you know, in that sense.
And what about, you know, this thing about female gaze and male gaze, and, you know, how do male?
Yeah. So the thing is that, you know, a lot of filmmakers, male filmmakers, have been called feminists, and like you have said that you have found that the women characters in even my films have some, you know, resonate with you, and all that is great. I feel very happy about that. I don't think male filmmakers can truly be feminists. I think they can be allies more than anything else. But because we, you know, it's like saying that as a filmmaker, and as an upper caste Hindu male, I'm fighting for the DBA movement. I mean, you can be an ally. You can't really feel what they've been through, you know. So yes, I definitely feel he's an ally. And I think in my own work, and I can speak for myself, you know, I don't know how others do it. The way I look at it is that, you know, you've got to write all your characters well, you know, regardless of their gender, you know. And so when you start talking about the primary characters in your film, I mean, some of them are going to be women, and then you've got to go inside that character's head as much as you're going inside your hero's head, be it Amir Khan or whosoever it is. And then when you do that, when you try to analyze, you know, the character that you're creating, I mean, you cannot separate the gender and that gender experience that character has, especially in a society like ours. I mean, you know, we're not in Sweden exactly. So then it flows naturally from there, you know. I think what interests me even in a film like Ishqiya, which is a lighthearted film ultimately, but what interests me again is power structures, you know. And when you talk about power structures, I mean, I think one of the easiest and one of the glaring examples in front of you is the gender inequality. You know, you see it very clearly. You see it in your everyday life. You see it in your own home. You know, so of course there is a certain amount of empathy that you have as a filmmaker, as a writer, to their condition, to what you've seen in your own life. I mean, you know, I've not seen violence directed at women in my personal life, but you know, the little things that patriarchy brings with it, we have all been witness to that, you know, in our own lives. So definitely there's a lot of empathy when there, but I think the primary duty of any filmmaker is to write all his characters well, to get inside their head, to work out their history, to work out their past. And when you're going to be talking about a woman character, you are going to be talking about her gender experience and the patriarchy that has been thrust upon her, you know, and then it flows from there naturally. I also think, as far as Ray Saab is concerned, I think there is a, in his own personal history, he was brought up by a single mother. And he comes from a really illustrious family, where some of the women were at the forefront of the movement, you could say. I mean, in the sense that they were highly educated, they were educated in medicine. So he comes from that side. So I think he's had the benefit of being around women with a lot of agency, with a lot of intellect. So I think that also shows in his work, you know, and that's why I think some of the women characters are so wonderful in his films. But I think you've got to credit more than anything else his humanist understanding, regardless of gender, and I think his craft as a writer, because all his characters were so good.
While reviewing Mahanagar, Roger Ebert actually said that, and I quote, "That is why I have so much trouble approaching race films as foreign. They are not foreign. They are about Indians, and I am not Indian, but race characters have more in common with me than I do to the comic strip characters of Hollywood." Sir, we have heard you say how much you value imbibing into the local to talk about a universal story. Yeah. And that is what we see when Roger Ebert describes race filmmaking. As a person who is not from Bengal, how much could you relate to the inherent flavor of Bengaliness in Ray films, say specifically in Mahanagar? And why do you think that the universality of the story needs to be portrayed through the local?
You know, I mean, I'll go away from Ray completely when I talk about, you know, when I talk about being local and global, because Ray is still very close to me personally, in the sense that I've been in the East, in a sense, you know. I understand Bangla culture very well. Most of my friends are Bengali. So, you know, so, I mean, when you say, watch a movie like Amores Perros, for example, I mean, it's on the other side of the world, literally. You know, you are in the northern hemisphere, southern hemisphere, in South America. And one of the stories is about the woman who has an affair with her brother-in-law, and they live in this, the dog story, and then they want to run away and all of that. When you're watching that story, doesn't it feel like it could be happening in the neighborhood slum where you are in Kolkata or me in Bombay? I mean, you know, so human experiences are very similar, you know. They are very similar. And I think while we should celebrate diversity, we should also understand that diversity is slightly overrated, because basically human beings are the same. You know, regardless of where they are, they have the same needs, they have the same emotional reaction to things. And it's only, you can talk about somebody's emotional experience and reaction to the world around her or him by understanding the specific issues of that world. You know, if you were to go to Punjab today, and why are they burning those crops, which is destroying Delhi's air, and you know, North Indian air, it is destroying it in the winters. And if you were to go and, you know, and you're pissed off, why are Punjabi farmers doing it? And you go to Punjab and you meet the farmers and you realize why they are doing it. It's a very specific Punjab political, economic, agricultural issue. And you talk about it, and you know, you realize that what they don't have a choice. You know, what are they going to do? You know, so when you talk about an individual's personal experience situated exactly in the environment that individual lives in, you will realize that you share some of the problems, or some of the problems, although the names are different, it's equivalent to your experience. You know, everybody needs the same things, you know, and this only the specific thing, specific situation changes, you know, but human experience is essentially the same. So therefore, that's the reason I believe that it's very important for us to be very specific in terms of the context of the story, to the time and the place. I think it's very important. And if we are very specific, even if we make a period film set in the 8th century AD, somewhere in Europe, you will find that it's commonly relating to you. You know, some of the issues that character is facing is something you understand very clearly, because ultimately it's about those basic emotions. Specifically talking about Ray, when Ebert says this, I mean, Ebert has said it very eloquently, but, you know, it's absolutely relatable what he's saying, because, you know, he was talking about, in his movies, he was talking about, well, for the lack of the better word, big things. You know, he was talking about the human experience. He was talking about what it is to be human and alive. But there was no shosha about it. You know what I'm saying? There was no grandstanding about it. I mean, the great thing about Ray compared even to his contemporaries, like Kurosawa or even the French masters, Kurosawa was grandiloquent, you know, he was making samurai films about great guys and, you know, warriors and shit like that. Even the French masters had a lot of grandstanding regard to form, you know, the form of their cinema. You know, there was a lot of grandstanding in Truffaut and Godard. I mean, they're geniuses of their craft, no doubt about it. Ray was very simple, you know, very, very human. There was no grandstanding. Even the visual symbolism that is there in the there in his films are done very easily, you know. There's no taking me kar raha hai bad thing, you know, like filmmakers like to show off a lot, you know? And some great filmmakers like to show off, and we admire them for it because they do it so well, you know. But there is very little of that in his films, you know. They're about people, ordinary people in ordinary circumstances, and but what he's talking about. You know, they are important stuff that he's talking about. Important stuff. He's talking about life, and he's talking about death, and he's talking about everything in between. But, you know, it's about human beings. There's no grandstanding in his cinematic grammar. You know, it's like today there are many filmmakers who, directly or indirectly, you can feel that. I mean, when you watch a movie like Shoplifters, for example, you know, you feel that. You know, the Japanese film, you know, at least 30, 40 years late after Ray has made his films. But you feel that, you know, it's about a family and, you know, what they're going through, they're ordinary people. So you feel that in those films. I think that's the reason why, because the experience of a family, the experience of characters in the particular context and space and time, that's what Ray does so well. The extraordinary stories of ordinary people that he did so well, you know. That's what makes him completely relatable, regardless of where you're from.
Thanks for this explanation, because like I remember in one of the interview with Smriti Kiran, you have mentioned about the importance of context.
Yes.
Like, and how you make it a key role in developing your films. Yeah. Somewhere you have elaborated it further, bringing in the context of Ray as well. Coming to the acting of the film, we would like to know, like, what do you think about the performance of Madhubi Mukherjee in Mohanagar? Because we personally feel it is probably even better than her performance in Charulata.
Yeah. In fact, you know, I'm always surprised when I realize that Mahanagar came before Charulata. Because Charulata, you have the sense that she's younger than she's even in Mahanagar. Because somehow, mentally for me, I don't know, I could be completely wrong, but for me, it feels like she's a young, you know, wife in her very early 20s or something in Charulata. And here she's a responsible woman, you know, with a son who is like 7 or 8 years old. So, I think it's absolutely a fantastic performance. There's no doubt about that. I mean, you know, and it's a completely measured performance. There's at no point, I feel that performance does more than it should or less than it should, you know. And there are certain moments in the film, of course, it's a film that's more than 50 years no, about 50 years. Sorry, 60 years almost. Yeah, sorry, my bad. It's a very old film. So some of the passages in the film, like for example, when the father-in-law is going through, father-in-law's track is a little melodramatic. Just thoda sa, it's melodramatic in the sense the way he goes and he talks to his students and he's feeling morose about his condition in his life and all of that. So it's a little melodramatic. But it doesn't happen with Madhavi. Even when Madhavi is with the father-in-law, you know, even her scenes, there's a scene in which a couple of scenes they have, you know, just two of them. But he never lets it go. She never lets go. She creates, you know, she's in control. Her balance is complete, you know, even in a very dramatic scene with the boss at the end, she never lets it go. Even with the scene, climax scene with the husband, she never lets it go. She never makes it melodramatic. It's so easy to do that. It's just so easy to do that. In the same script, you know, in the hands of an inferior director, would have at least 10 to 15 very melodramatic moments with Sarangi playing in the background. I mean, you know, it's going to happen. Yeah, because it's so easy. It's so easy to give in. And you know, these things happen because of directors and actors' insecurity. Nothing else. Because on set, they will be asking the actors to do more, or in post-production, they will telling the BGM guys to do more. Only because they're insecure, is it getting conveyed or not? You know, a lot of times directors make the mistake, I'm worried about communication. So, you know, this should be louder. I don't think people are getting it. Ray, thankfully, or Madhavi Mukherjee's performance was not insecure. It was completely within control, you know. And it's wonderful because she had so many moments where she could let it go, you know, just when she has... And there are so many emotions. She experiences confusion. She experiences sadness. She experiences defeat. You know, and there are melodramatic moments, you know, with a father-in-law, with her husband, but she never lets it go. And I think amongst all of Ray's characters, this is definitely going to be one of the most iconic ones. I mean, you know, one of the most iconic characters that he has created, regardless of gender. It's definitely... Madhavi Mukherjee is the number one heroine that she created. I mean, and he's had some wonderful actresses working for him. But I think she will be on top of the list, I would feel. Yeah, and I, Madhavi Mukherjee is actually, when I was making Ishqi, I showed Vidya a photograph of Madhavi Mukherjee. Of course, she knew that. That, you know, this is, I mean, she's a Bengali woman from the 1960s and we are creating another character in UP. But something should be similar.
I think there's a beautiful thing that her gait changes when she gains the confidence slowly. And you know, the voice remains same, but the gait changes, the confidence shows.
Yes. And there are shots when she's walking the streets and all of that. Yeah, you realize that there's this, and it's just done gradually, you know, it's done gradually. Yeah.
You know, another very interesting thing, Abhishek, is that the actual original story based on which Mahanagar is, Abodharanika, the ending is actually different. I mean, the husband does not actually support the wife that much. He kind of taunts. But Shatrughit deviated from the ending. And I just wanted to know about the ending from you. I mean, now that you know, do you think this is a, you know, more hopeful, more human, as we were talking about, ending to Mahanagar, as Ray has carved out to be?
Yeah, I've not read the short story because is it a short story or a
it's
novel?
A short, yes.
I've not read it, of course. But the ending, I think, of Mahanagar, you know, actually, when we look at the ending of, I think the ending is very important to the film. The way it ends is very important to the film. I mean, you know, and I think you could possibly feel. It is possible that one could feel that it is slightly naive, you know, because now we're in 2021. I think even Ray thought it naive when he was making Pratidwandi. I think the era that it was made in 1963, that was the era of Nehru. The film seemed to be saying at one level that, okay, there are many problems in our country, you know. But if we are strong and morally upright, you know, if we have moral integrity, we will be able to deal with those problems. You know that. So that's what he tries to say. I mean, you know. So like I said, I feel the film's fundamental engagement is with power structures and changing power structures, right? And what you have is that in this new India that we are seeing, in this new India that's just emerged, it's not even 5, 6, or 7 years since the independence, you are seeing these new people with more access to power, which is, say, Aarti's boss, you know. And in very typical Nehruvian fashion, I mean, you know, this is new capitalism that is there. And the power structures have changed. Now, the English who are in power, 5, 6 years ago, are their descendants are disenfranchised in Edith, you know, and the Indian capitalist boss, you could say, you know, is the new power, and we have to join that mainstream. We have to join it, but we should do it without letting go of our moral integrity. That's what he's saying, because that's what happens in Aarti's case, because when she realizes that the boss is a bigoted man, that the boss is being committing injustice, you know, to somebody who's of her own, she takes a moral stand. It's a moral stand. It's an act of extreme stupidity, you know, given the economic condition of her family. But she takes a moral stand against it, you know, and she then immediately, when she meets her husband and they go down, she regrets it. She says, "Arey, galti ho gaya. I should not have done it. This is not, I, it was an emotional decision. I lost my, you know," but he ends it on a note of hope when he says, "This is such a big city. There are so many offices. There's so many jobs. I think we'll be all right." Something like that. He says, "We'll be all right." So this Nehruvian era hope, you know, that, okay, things are fucked, you know. Okay, but we are building them factories. We are building those educational institutions. We are building those, and we'll be all right, you know. And just 5 years later, he must have realized, oh shit.
We see the anger more in Pratidwandi or Janwar.
Yeah, because that's another of his Calcutta films, which I think more than the Calcutta trilogy, I think relates very directly to Mahanagar. Mahanagar, I think, is the prologue to the Calcutta trilogy, which is much more angry, you know.
Yeah.
Mahanagar, there is no anger in Mahanagar. There's no rage in Mahanagar. But in these films, you know, you can see the rage, because from Nehru, we had gone to Indira Gandhi and it's all spot.
And then somewhere the boss in Mahanagar kind of reminds me of the characters from Simhabadhu. It seemed like it's like...
Yeah, very, very Simhabadhu.
The whole setting of Simhabadhu. He could have been anyone from Simhabadhu.
Yeah.
Abhishek sir, actually, this was such a pleasure to be with you. And in fact, when you were talking about Mahanagar, actually, it opened up so much more for me. Like, I have viewed Mahanagar 3 or 4 times. And still, once you explained the politics, I mean, of Mahanagar at the bigger level, it was so great. Plus, you talked about your own films. It was so enriching and you gave us so much of time. Thank you so much, sir. We are truly indebted.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, guys. Thank you. Lovely talk. Thank you.